Hey guys, welcome back to Best Movies Recap. A girl who is just released from the prison tries to perform the biggest robbery in history by stealing the jewelry of the royal family with a team only consisting of women. Today we are talking about the action-adventure movie Ocean's 8 from 2018. Before we get started, if you are new to the channel, subscribe to our family and turn on the notification bell to receive our coming videos. The movie starts in a similar way to Ocean's 11. A convicted thief named Debbie Ocean, who is also Danny's younger sister, is attending a parole hearing. Debbie has spent the last 5 years in prison, and her infamous brother Danny has recently died. The parole board tells Debbie the restrictions of any parolee, which gonna force her to avoid the company of any person who has a criminal record of any kind, and that includes her family. Debbie reveals that she is more than ready to rejoin society and continue to live a simple life and pay her bills. After that, Debbie is checking out and takes her stuff, including the last remaining from her brother, his watch, which apparently he stole, and Debbie steal it from him. Then she leaves the prison. The first thing she does upon being released was visit a department store in New York City and pinch several items after pretending that she was there to return them. She then goes to a hotel and noticed a couple checking out. She waits a few minutes and then calls the hotel reception, pretending to be part of the couple, saying that her flight is cancelled. She asks them to give her back the same room and to send a hotel maid to clean it. Then Debbie steals more items on her way to the hotel room and gets inside it without a need for a key. On the other side, Debbie's former partner in crime Lou is now working in a bar where she and her cohorts are watering down vodka, because when people get drunk, they cannot differentiate between real vodka and the fake one. At this moment, Lou receives a message from her partner to meet with her. Meanwhile, Debbie visits Danny's tomb, where Ruben Tishkoff appears, telling her that she doesn't have to do whatever she is planning to do next. But she refused his advice and calmed him down after revealing that she is not going to end up in jail again. She exits the cemetery to find her partner Lou waiting for her, then the two head to Lou's house. On the way, Debbie informs Lou that she is planning to steal Liz Taylor's jewels that are locked in a vault 15 feet underground. Earlier on that day, Debbie also goes to find her ex-boyfriend Claude Becker, an art dealer who also snitched on her and caused her to get sent to jail. She finds him at his art gallery and intimidates him with a shiv made from a toothbrush, but she only takes a button off his shirt and leaves. The next morning, Debbie and Lou take a visit to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, where the upcoming Met Gala is about to be held, and it is also Debbie's target of the heist. The two then head to a restaurant and start discussing the plan. Lou wasn't convinced at all, but Debbie ensures her that the plan gonna succeed, and she will no longer have to waste her time watering vodka again. Debbie starts telling her the detail of the plan in which she spent her last 5 years in jail thinking of it. The plan is to steal a valuable diamond necklace called the Toussaint, which is worth $150 million. By the way, this is exactly the same amount of money Danny stole in his first heist. She wants to use snobby socialite Daphne Kluger as the mule, so she can wear it to the Met Gala, where it can be taken. First, Debbie needs to assemble a crew in order to achieve her goals. Debbie and Lou go to find Rose Weil, a local fashion designer whose work isn't nearly as regarded as it was back then, and she is in debt to the IRS. The two find Rose crying and eating Nutella, where they propose the idea to her so that she can earn herself some money and solve her debt. Debbie then reunites with another old friend named Amita, an Indian jewelry maker who used to do shady work for Debbie, and she still lives with her mother. Amita immediately accepts to join Debbie when she tells her she won't have to live with her mom after this. Next, Lou introduces Debbie to a computer hacker who calls herself Nine Ball and shows how good she is by hacking into the building's power line and reinforcing its security system. Debbie and Lou then find a street hustler named Constance Wong, who is a pro at pickpocketing. While talking with her, she manages to steal their watches, but since Debbie is also a professional thief, she caught her. Finally, Debbie visits another old friend named Tammy, a reliable fence who is enjoying a quiet life as a wife and mom in suburbia, but Debbie notices that a lot of things in Tammy's garage are stolen goods. And like the others, Tammy joins as well. The seven women meet at Lou's loft, where Debbie divulges the plan to the ladies and how they will infiltrate the Met Gala in order to steal the necklace, and so that each one of them will get $16.5 million within 5 weeks. First, the ladies have Rose meet at a local restaurant with a celebrity named Penelope Stern to potentially dress her for the gala. Then the two women take a picture of Rosa holding Penelope's hand and put it in a famous newspaper. When Daphne sees the meeting in the tabloids, she gets jealous and orders her manager to set up her own meeting with Rose so that she can dress her instead. Then, they arrange for Rose and Amita to see the Toussaint so that the necklace's owners may be persuaded to let Daphne wear it for the gala. In the beginning, the manager refuses to show her the necklace, but then Rose manages to convince him by speaking in French. The ladies give Rose special glasses to wear so it can scan the necklace and send it to a 3D printer that will print a replica of the necklace made out of zirconium, which they will switch for the real necklace. But inside the vault, there is no signal, so Amita and Rose tell the employee that they need to see it under the sunlight. Then Rose succeeds in scanning the necklace with the glasses. On the other side, the 3D print made a replica of the necklace. While Rose visits and boosts the confidence of Daphne by telling her that she is the perfect woman to wear the Toussaint. After that, Debbie visits the museum to check the security system there. Then she tells the news that the political artist Banksy has sneaked into the museum and added one of his paintings. Later on that day, the manager of the museum made a meeting with the company responsible for its security, and he orders them to add more protection and to recheck everything before the party. While the security employees were leaving, Wong steals an entrance card and then gives it to Nine Ball, who pretends to be a worker there. She sneaks into the meeting and put a spying device to know everything about the new modification to the security system. Meanwhile, Tammy reveals to Debbie that Cartier has hired the best private security in the world to protect the necklace. Guillermo de Vita, who was leading the Pope's security for 10 years. And Yuri Eshel, a former Mossad and IDF special forces. On the other side, Nine Ball find the person who is responsible for putting the cameras in the security company, and after checking his Facebook and knowing that he liked dogs, she sent him a link with a puppy picture and hacked his computer. And after he leaves, she takes a copy of the plan for the security cameras. The crew then gets themselves into the event as part of the staff, with Tammy being hired as a coordinator. She gets Constance, Amita, and Lou in as part of the kitchen staff. Nine Ball hacks into the computer of someone working the event to get a view of the seating arrangements for the event. Debbie plans to have Claude meet Daphne so that he can be her date. Lou then realizes Debbie is planning to frame Claude in a revenge scheme. A flashback shows 10 years earlier when Debbie first met Claude, and they hit it off. He got her involved in a fraud scheme, and his testimony against her was what got her locked up. Debbie tries to assure Lou that the job is strictly to get the necklace. The next morning, when Daphne does get to wear the necklace, Rose discovers that the necklace can only be removed by using a special magnet. So she records a video to show the team how it works. They find themselves in a dilemma, but Nine Ball comes up with a solution after calling her sister, who knows what to use in order to remove the necklace without that particular magnet. The night of the Met Gala arrives. And celebrities like Kim Kardashian, Heidi Klum, Common, Serena Williams, and Katie Holmes all appearing as themselves are in attendance. The crew gets into positions, with Debbie posing as a German socialite with dyed blonde hair and using her skilled knowledge of the German language. Daphne shows up with Claude as her date after Debbie had it made so that they could meet and hit it off. Lou adds something to Daphne's soup that causes her to run to the bathroom to start vomiting. Wong manages to swipe the necklace off her as her head is in the toilet. She passes the necklace to Amita, who goes to a staff bathroom to start splitting the diamonds of the necklace. After Daphne leaves the bathroom, her bodyguards notice that the necklace is missing. They lock the place down as they go searching for it. Before Amita can be found by a guard, Tammy pulls out the zirconium fake necklace and hands it over. Constance then gets the diamonds and hands the individual pieces to the rest of the crew, and Debbie takes some diamonds from the necklace and places them on Becker. Then all the team members start leaving the party with pieces of the necklace. The next day, the fake necklace is discovered. An insurance fraud investigator named John Fraser gets on the case, as he knows about Debbie and her family's history, as well as the fact that she was spotted at the event. Fraser speaks to Claude, Daphne's guards, and the gala's staff as they are suspects. He then talks to Daphne and even Debbie herself, to which he confirms that it was a revenge scheme. After that, the ladies are at their hideout when Daphne enters. Debbie and Lou revealed that they called her in because she was starting to catch on to their scheme, since Rose was recording the day they found out about the magnet. Daphne is actually eager to join since she doesn't have many female friends, and she finds this to be exciting. Daphne later arranged a romantic date with Becker to frame him. With Becker handcuffed to the bed in the other room, she finds the diamonds that Debbie stowed in his jacket pocket and photographs them in his apartment, giving Fraser the evidence he needs for a warrant, which is made worse for Claude, and Claude is sent to jail. The crew celebrates their success, but Daphne points out that stealing the one necklace and splitting it eight ways didn't sound like a great plan. That's when Debbie reveals that they stole all the necklaces from the gala during the lockdown. It turns out that Debbie and Lou had their sights set on more than the Cartier necklace. Earlier in the film, Daphne leads a camera crew through this section of the exhibit, teasing what will be on display during the Met Gala. When the security evacuated guests, Lou and Yen, the Chinese acrobat from the original Ocean's 11 crew, sneak into the exhibit and steal the jewelry on display. Yen climbs above the display and suspends down, dodging the lasers that would tip off security. He gathers the jewels and places them in a bag and gives it to Lou through the water, then he places a replica of the jewels on display before security returns. With all the money they want, the ladies split off to do whatever they want. Amita gets her own house and moved to Paris with a new boyfriend. Rose opens up her own dress shop and paid all her debt. Constance gets her own place in the city and starts making videos. Tammy opens and operates a warehouse with more stolen goods. And Nineball continues her hacker work and opens its own billiards hall. While Daphne becomes a film director and even directs Anne Hathaway. Lou gets herself a motorcycle and goes on a cross-country road trip by herself. In the final scene of the movie, Debbie goes back to Danny's tomb with a martini to tell him about the heist, saying, "You would have loved it." Thanks for watching. If you liked the video, put a like and share it. Also, don't forget to subscribe for more. Have a great day.